In this lecture, we'll learn how contraction of a star-forming cloud slows, what rotation has to do with starbirth, and how nuclear fusion begins in a newborn star. We left off with a massive cloud of interstellar gas and dust collapsing. As our cloud collapses, the center gets hotter and hotter. Eventually, thermal pressure begins to slow the cloud's collapse. Exciting things are about to happen. A cloud fragment will continue to collapse on itself as long as it remains cold, and it can remain cold as long as photons emitted by molecules within the cloud can carry away the energy released by gravitational contraction. Early on, this is easy because the cloud's density is still fairly low. The photons can escape. As the contraction continues, though, it's harder for the photons to get out. At this point, thermal energy builds up and the pressure inside the star increases. The contraction slows down and the cloud fragment officially becomes a protostar. A protostar will continue to grow in mass as it takes on more material from the molecular cloud. The outer material from the cloud will fall inward and the protostar will get more massive. This continues until the gas is gone, either blown away from the protostar or a neighboring star. Observations of young stars show that their births can be quite violent. There's a rotational component to starbirth that causes some interesting phenomena, like enormous jets of gas that shoot off from just formed stars. The random motions of gas particles in a molecular cloud give it some initial rotation. As it contracts, it spins faster and faster. This is a result of the law of conservation of angular momentum. This rapid rotation prevents gas from raining directly down onto the protostar. Instead, it settles into a protostellar disk. These protostellar disks can coalesce into planetary systems like our solar system. Observations show that many protostars fire high-speed streams of gas or jets into space. We generally see two jets shooting outward in opposite directions along the protostar's rotation axis. No one knows exactly how protostars generate these jets, but the fact that they are aligned with the disk's rotation axis suggests angular momentum plays a role. Angular momentum is also the reason so many stars belong to binary star systems. As the molecular cloud contracts, breaks up into fragments, and forms protostars, some of these protostars end up quite close to one another. Gravity can pull two neighboring protostars closer together, but they won't crash into one another. Instead, they go into orbit around each other because each pair of protostars has a certain amount of angular momentum. We can't really call a protostar a star until nuclear fusion in its core begins. Fusion will happen when the core gets hot enough, and the core is getting hotter as the protostar accretes more and more mass. A protostar becomes a true star when its core temperature exceeds 10 million Kelvin. This is hot enough for the proton-proton chain to begin. The star is now a main sequence star. The length of time from the formation of the protostar to the birth of a main sequence star depends on the star's mass. Massive stars do everything faster. The contraction of a high-mass protostar into a spectral type O main sequence star will take less than a million years. A star like our Sun takes about 30 million years. A very low-mass M star can spend 100 million years as a protostar. That's all for now. I'll leave you with this image of a region within the Carina Nebula called Mystic Mountain. The columns you see have been carved out of the Carina Nebula by winds from young stars just born.